Good morning to one and all. Let us start our discussion. I hope I am audible to you.
So you are audible.
Before we proceed to the topic for today's discussion, I think Neha, is she online? Neha. I think she is off now again. Anyway, any queries for the last week's discussions? Yeah, I think Neha, are you online now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, can you please present from your side so that I can see if there is a problem? For others, there was a doubt from Neha for one of the programming tasks. So just let us complete that and we'll continue with our topics.
Sir, is my screen visible? Okay, sir, this is regarding an LED and button program, simple. So what is happening is I am also printing this button dot read sync value because we are checking this value here in the while loop. If it is one, then only LED will blink or high or low, right? So here I have connected with Raspberry Pi and I'll again load my SVG and netlist.
So you have prepared your SVG and this netlist using FreeSync?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Using FreeSync. Sir, this is it. Now, see, sir, the value is coming as zero of button.readSync and LED is not glowing.
Yeah, you need to see this logic is what is the logic of this program?
So this one.
What is the logic? You tell me.
Button dot means button should also be whenever we are pressing the button and checking the blink status so that we are keeping LED high or low.
Right, right, exactly. So now you can you please run once again? Can you go back? No, first stop execution once, please. Yes, stop that one.
Yes.
So your button is connected to pin number 22 and your LED is connected to pin number 4, right? Am I right?
Yes, sir.
That's
Yes,
fine.
sir.
Can you run it again?
Sure, sir.
Okay, now you press the button here first. First you click the button, yes. Yeah, now it is glowing.
Okay. I was missing this point, sir, to press the button. Okay.
So there you see everything
Okay,
you have
thank
done
you
and
so much.
yeah. Once again you press it should be off here. Yeah.
Okay, yes, sir, understood.
Unless
Sir, it was
you
new
press
to
the
me,
button, see the logic of that code is if you press the button, then the LED is going to on. If you don't press the button, how do you think that the LED will be on?
Yes, sir, but I was new to this, so I was not aware that here also we can do. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. So your doubt is clarified? Yeah.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir, I'll stop present.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Any other queries, please? Please let me know. If you have any queries, please please put forward. Because yes, please.
Sir, can we do that app in React Native, sir?
Which app you are talking about?
The assignment.
Yes, you can. It is not restricted to only this Android Studio. You can do it, no problem.
Okay, thanks.
React Native, if you know what are the technologies. So somebody says that they know Flutter also, so you can use Flutter also. There is no doubt. Because let me share with you that I'm also using Flutter now. The last week I'm also learning how to use Flutter and how to program. So I will also show you how to use this Flutter maybe at the end of the session. For some of you, may be useful for you. Of course, this is the latest technology that will be very useful for our IoT also. Anyway, so any other queries, please? If you are not having any questions, then we will proceed to the next our topics of our today's discussion. Is my screen visible to you?
No, sir, not right now. Yes, sir, now it's visible.
Actually, when I was interacting with you in the last session, some of you are still unable to give me the answer about what are sensors, actuators, and what is ADC, and what are all these things. So let me give you some more information, and of course, to make you have clarity before proceeding to the programming part and other application development. So I have provided some material to you, which I prepared myself. So this you can see. Hope my screen is visible to you, right?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Yes, sir.
So this is in addition to the slides which I already shared to you. So this material also will be helpful for you to have some more understanding on what are sensors, actuators, and what we are going to use this in our day-to-day life. So that also, of course, I am not stressing much on electronics, instrumentation, and electrical part, because most of you are computer science guys, so you need not worry about the fabrication, the circuit designs, and all. But at least the big picture of all these devices and how to use these devices for IoT is most important for us. So I will make sure that at least you understand by the end of this session. Have more clarity, and you should not forget this basic fundas related to these IoT's fundamental things. Right. Before we proceed, let me ask you: can you please provide something an analogy between our sensing and the actuators? Very basic an analogy. If anybody can tell me about the difference between or the functionality between sensor and an actuator. With some knowledge which you have in the previous class discussions,
sir.
Yes, please.
So one analogy can be like we are inhaling oxygen, that could be our like sensor, and we are exhaling carbon dioxide, that can be treated as an actuator, sir.
Yeah, exhaling process is an actuating process only. Of course, you have mostly means you are on to the track, but I cannot. Give you the complete marks here. As far as the actuator, you have missed something there. Yeah, any more views, please? You are on the track. Very good. Good attempt. Really excellent attempt, Amit. So, yeah. Any other views, please? Some kind of analogy between sensors and actuators. Okay, I'll put for the I'll put the question in another way. Everybody, please try to understand this basic thing here. Then it will be almost clear for you. See, we, as your friend Amit just now said, sensing, of course, now you are inhaling and exhaling your oxygen, you are inhaling the oxygen and you are exhaling the carbon dioxide. With respect to the same example, let us move forward. So, for our human body, we have a sense organs. So once you sense, what is that going to happen? Very simple answer, please. Expecting. Once you,
So it would trigger a response from the brain.
Good. Once you sense, you will get your sense information is being processed by your brain. Very good. And after the brain, after that, what is going to happen? It triggers the brain, and brain, what is going to do? and so nose will be active.
Yeah, go ahead, Pranav.
Sir, like brain sends a signal to nose to inhale.
Inhale or exhale. So, right, very good, very simple process here. So here there are three things here: your sense organ, your brain, and the brain gives the action part to another organ of your body. So it can be nose, it can be ear, it can be mouth, it can be a simple hand. So you are getting a signal from the brain. Am I right? Are you getting these points, please, everybody? So you sense the environment. So when you touch a hot surface, or when you touch a cold surface, when you smell, something like you can, these are all your sense organs. Your nose, you can smell, of course. With ears, you can hear. So you can hear the sound. And once your sense organs are sensed, it is getting processed at the brain. Please remember, it is getting processed at the brain. And the brain gives the action part for the another body organ to perform. Very simple. Sense, brain, and the body. Three things. Similarly, here in the our real world, if you look to the digital ICT world, here also you have a sensor. And the equivalent part of the brain is the processor. The processor here is the microcontroller. And what that processor is going to do, it is going to give some action part to the body. That body is nothing but basically your actuator. Please remember this. So your actuator is one thing which is going to get some signals from basically from a processor or a microcontroller to do something. So to do and to play with the something. So that's the actuator. Don't confuse very much between a sensor and an actuator. I hope, are you clear with this small example? Do I need to put it on something on the diagrammatic form?
No, sir, it's clear.
Yeah. So here, the sensors and actuators, if you look here, in our day-to-day life, you might have seen these simple pictures. So what you see here carefully, let us see here, you might have seen your bulb in your home, you might have seen a microphone, or of course this picture is very old picture, but still it gives you a lot of information. And you might have seen on the right side a motor, electric motor in your home, you might have used for your water pumping or for some other purposes. So basically all these are nothing but transducers. Please remember, a transducer, what is a transducer? In the previous class we have discussed, a transducer is any device which converts one form of energy into another. Very simple. One energy to another form. One form to another form. So here a microphone converts sound into electrical impulses, and a loudspeaker converts your electrical impulses into a sound, and vice versa here. Similarly, a solar cell converts light into electricity, one form of energy to another form. And a thermocouple converts thermal energy into electrical energy. Similarly, your incandescent bulb, light bulb, produces light by passing a current through a filament. So thus a light bulb is a transducer for converting electrical energy into optical energy, the light and the heat energy here. So electrical motor is a transducer for conversion of electricity into mechanical energy or motion. So these are all the examples of a transducers. Now in this, there is a sensor and there is an actuator. Can you please tell me if you understood a sensor and actuator, which is an actuator and which is a sensor here?
That mic is the sensor and that bulb and motor is the actuator.
Yeah. So here the motor is basically is an actuator. It is a transducer, but it does an actuation function. So what does it does? It converts electricity to mechanical energy, basically. So you get some signals from somebody to motor to on or operate or to off something. So this is an actuator, basically. And of course, the microphone is basically sensing your sound, or it is going to be collecting the sound waves, and the sound waves have been converted to your you can get the corresponding electrical, and it is going to be getting amplified in this case. But similarly, if you see here, we as in human beings are equipped with five different types of sensors: your eye, your ear, your nose, and your mouth, and as well as your hand. So we also sense every day. We sense something. All these are your sense organs. So basically, when you sense and you give that information to your brain, and the brain tells you what needs to be done, so some action is going to come. So here, the sensors are basically the sensing the environment. Your brain is nothing but your microcontroller, or you can call it as a processor. So then the brain gives signals to the corresponding body organs to do some action based on the processed information on the microcontroller. The similar things, that's what you need to understand here, very simple things. So basic concepts of transducers, to be more specific, how these transducers are being prepared. I think everybody have seen this diagram in their school days. Have you seen this diagram, some kind of thing in your school days, please? In your school days means during your physics class or your electronics class in intermediate.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
The students might have
right
seen
one,
this
one.
Yeah, the right, yes, the right one only, the right side figure. Most of you might have seen this one. This is nothing but an example for a battery. If you see, this is your battery, or in your home, everybody might have seen a battery. So what does that battery is basically, what does that battery do? Of course, it gives you some kind of energy, voltage, and the current is being produced. So you get some energy, and that energy will help you to glow the bulb, or to use an electronic device, or to use another thing. But if internally, if you see, that battery is nothing but some chemical energy. That chemical energy is converted to your electrical energy. Are you getting this point? Basically, there is a chemical energy between this anode and the cathode. So this anode and the cathode, these are electrodes. Basically, anode and cathodes are nothing but electrodes. These electrodes are made with some chemical substrates, chemical substances, and they are being separated by using a salt bridge, which needs to conduct and produce some energy for you. So these are being separated at both the ends. That means they are being put separately, these chemical substances. And that chemical energy, once they get a reaction between themselves, and you get the energy. That energy, you are going to make use it for your electronic appliances or your bulbs to be glowing. That is a very simplest concept. So basically, your battery converts chemical energy directly into electrical energy. So it is also a sensor, basically. It is also one type of transducer. I can say a sensory property is there, as well as actuator property is also there here. Basically, when actuation is happening, that actuation is coming from the electrical energy that is being derived from that chemical energy itself. So that electrical energy is driving the electrical bulb to glow, or make some other, if you connect some motor, that motor is going to operate here. So like this, you might have seen there are so many types of transducers in our day-to-day life. So these are this type of transducers are basically electrochemical transducers. Because there is a chemical reaction is also happening here, and you also get some kind of electrical energy that is being generated from those chemical energies. So the left side of figure is also some kind of chemical reactions between here you have the different kinds of fuel which is going to be powering on to generate the energy here. So you have the hydrogen and you have the oxygen chemical substances. And of course, you have the other substrates here, and that makes up the energy here. Simplest thing is nothing but your battery only. That is another form of representation. That is only the diagrammatic representation which is given. Like this, you have different types of transducers. So you can see there is an electroacoustic and electromagnetic, electrostatic transducers. So do not confuse with all these types of electrochemical substances and the names and the keywords and this. But nevertheless, in your books, when you refer to various types of applications, and you see they're all related to the same, and they are almost the meaning is going to be the same here. So the electroacoustic transducers are nothing but your loudspeaker. The name is only, you might have not known. Electroacoustic. Acoustic, of course, the sound. Acoustic stands for your sound terminology. So your loudspeaker, what does your loudspeaker do? Converts an electrical signal into your sound. That's what we can hear the sound from a long distance too. Whereas a microphone converts your sound waves in air into your electrical signals, and that are been converted, and it is been digitized, and it is been sent to other side. So hydrophone converts sound waves in water into an electrical signal. So this is what we see it in collecting the data from your underwater or on seas and oceans. So if you see here, electromagnetic transducers, this is another term, electromagnetic here. Of course, the magnetic properties and the magnetic principles comes into picture for getting the magnetic field. So conversion converts motion in a magnetic field into an electric energy. Of course, you might have seen the generator itself, your motor, is a magnetic field into your electrical energy is being generated. So these are the different types. So please go through these notes and you can understand the terms and it will be useful for you. And you will not get confused and they will not be making any problem for you in the later stages of your work. So similarly, you have all this. So you are, if you look to your bulb itself, so your bulb, what does your bulb is doing? Is converting electrical energy into light and heat or your optical energy. Specifically, an incandescent light bulb consists of a vacuum. You might have seen a vacuum chamber and you have tungsten filament here. The tungsten filament, of course, this is you are going to connect this tungsten filament is a separator between your anode and your cathode that is being powered up with your electrical line. So here, a filament, typically a tungsten and a positive and a negative terminals. So the negative terminal is a part that screws into the socket and to prevent electrical shock. So a voltage source is placed across this positive. So you are getting your light light to be grown from your electrical energy, which is passing through this particular anode and your cathode connected by your tungsten filament. So if you look to this, so these are all sensors that we use it in our day-to-day life, sensors and actuators, of course. All these are basically your transducers only. So they are not different from our any other device which you use in our day-to-day life. So just go through this terminology and it will be easy for you to get on with the other topics later. So some of the topics here, and one more example is, of course, the thermometer itself. Many of you have seen this thermometer. The thermometer is also is basically a temperature sensor. So whenever you get some fever, obviously you might have used this thermometer. So this is again, it is converting from, it is also a transducer more or less and converts your energy, your heat, which is going to be converted into a appropriate reading that you see through the mercury level here. So that is also a sensor here. Now my question is, most of you might have seen a wall clock or a your hand watch or it. What about a watch of your day-to-day wearing device? Day-to-day life you are seeing. Is a watch a sensor or an actuator?
Sir, actuator.
Yes, so here the watch, whatever you are using, it is controlling the those needles and those arrow marks of your clocks to move further from the motor. That is actually a small motor which will tilt those particular set of values. Now, the other important thing that everyone should also be aware is there are different types of sensors. So, of course, sensors are basically your transducers, convert one form to another form. And now these sensors are also are of different types. So in simple terms, what is an active sensor? So a sensor that requires external power to operate. So you need to provide external energy. So until unless you don't give some external power, then those phenomenon of converting one form to another form does not happen. So some examples here, you can have something like the carbon microphone, thermistors, strain gauges, capacitive and inductive sensors. And so these are also called as parametric sensors. There's a parameters are involved here. So this sensor that requires external power, please remember, very simple answer, very easy to remember also. So just have an understanding here. This active sensors, active means those sensors are being powered externally or being provided extra energy for them. Whereas passive sensors generates its own electrical signal and does not require a power source. These are called as passive sensors. So your thermocouples, magnetic microphones, piezoelectric sensors, internally your electrical signal is going to be generated. The energy helps in converting one form to another form. So they are called as passive sensors. So these are active sensors which need external energy. Passive sensors, already the energy is inbuilt in the phenomenon process to convert from one form to another form. Now, that's why these are also called self-generating sensors. That passive sensors are called self-generating. Self-generating means power, self-power generation or self-energy generation. Now you have other types of sensors like contact and non-contact sensors. Contact sensors, a sensor that requires physical contact with the stimulus. Means a stimulus means you are getting contact with the environment. Some kind of physically you need to touch to the other environment. So you like your temperature sensors. Until unless you don't touch, means you, if you don't, you, a sensor is not touched to your body, you will not get the temperature to be read for some of them. So of course nowadays if you see infrared sensors are there. So you, your infrared, you are going to measure the temperature. That's why touchless. For this COVID, you might have seen some people try to measure the body temperature. So that is basically a touchless sensor. So those are non-contact sensors. Those are called non-contact sensors. That requires no physical contact. Whatever you are seeing on nowadays, everywhere, people at your offices or at the different places, they try to, before you enter their premises, they try to monitor what is your body temperature. So these are basically non-contact sensors. So there are through other mechanisms, other phenomenon, other than the mercury and your normal temperature sensors, they do measure the temperature. So similarly, you have something called absolute and relative sensors. What are called absolute sensors? A sensor that reacts to stimulus on an absolute scale. So in the absolute scale means there's an exact value. So the exact value, it is going to be there. And whereas a relative is going to be a difference or a variable reference. So a relative sensor means it is in correlation with the other values. It is not going to be a fixed one, but variable values. So a correlation set of values. These are called as relative sensors. So of course, most of the time, the pressure sensors are going to be called as relative sensors. You get the relative values based on the pressure that is being the force which is been exerting certain filament to release its values. You get the corresponding sensor values. There are other types of sensors too, which are given in the previous discussion. May I know what is that particular sensor, sir? In addition to these three types, which you might have already seen in your mobile phones, there are other types of sensors other than this active and passive and contact and non-contact and absolute and relative sensors. We have some sensors which have been termed as something which are available on your mobile phones too. During the mobile phone sensors discussion, I mentioned this point. Any idea? Can you recollect this?
Virtual sensor.
Very good, very good. So who is that person? Chanda Saha, very good. You remember that point. So virtual sensors, what are virtual sensors, please? You rightly mentioned that.
Software process that make use of those sensors.
Very good. So instead of really the sensor, a sensor is there won't be any transducer. It's not a sensor. There won't be any transducer. It means there won't be any kind of this. Whatever you are seeing here, they are not active or they are not passive. They are not contact. They are not non-contact sensors. They are not absolute and relative sensors. They are not physically existing at all. They are not really existing. But they are they have been showing you the values through your software program only. They are called as virtual sensors. Virtual means they are not existing in real world. So that is what virtual sensors. Example of a virtual sensor, anybody? In your mobile phone, they are not really existing, but they'll give you the sensing values. Those are called your virtual values through your software programs only. Can anybody give me some example of a virtual sensor?
Sir, a speedometer.
Speedometer. Speedometer. Which speedometer you are talking about? See, basically, your virtual sensors will be there on your mobile phones, not your speedometer. Something you are trying, please.
Yes, sir. When we travel long distance quickly, it shows that you traveled so fast.
Yeah, so just the speedometer, based on the revolutions of your wheel, of your vehicle, that speedometer will tell you how fast you are moving and as well as how many kilometers you have traveled. So that is actually it is connected to your motor of your wheel only. So that is not the example here, please. I'm talking about accelerometer. Accelerometer also, there is a physically, there is an accelerometer, MEMS technology accelerometer. I have shown the figure, which is there in your mobile phone. No.
Sir, GPS sensor?
GPS sensor. Can anybody tell me what is the GPS sensor is?
Sir, it's it triangulates the location of a mobile phone or a device with respect
to satellite. This is basically through the location here. So, if you might have seen, already this location sensors are available in your mobile phone. Any idea, please?
Sir, that speedometer means, I think he is trying to tell like that by the GPS that phone sometimes so how...
Okay. So, he is relating to that one. Yes. Okay, now I got your point here. Yes, that's what those things are not existing really. So these are basically your, yes, that is one good example only. Yeah, I understand now. Yeah. Any other place? You have so many actually virtual sensors in your electronic devices, in your tabs or in your laptops, in your these things. So please find out and let me know. Okay, I'll move on to this next one. So if you see here, these are the another classifications of different sensors. If you see, there are so many, something like electric sensors, magnetic sensors, electromagnetic, acoustic, chemical sensors, optical sensors, temperatures, mechanical, radiation, biological sensors. So like this, if you see, these are all different, and these sensors are used for different applications. So if you see the consumer products, electrical sensors, military applications, health, energy, manufacturing, transportation, automotive, avionics, space, scientifics. So this, you can just have a quick read of these things and you will understand and get it. So now let us move forward to have some more understanding on an analog sensor. What is an analog sensor? So obviously, you are going to sense the environment. Environment can be, it produces basically the analog value only. So this analog sensor is going to give sense the environment with analog value as an input and gives the output also as an analog only. So in between, you have the analog signal processing. That's nothing but it is giving you the analog value only, again, the output. Something like your temperature, your speed, your displacement, pressures, your strain gauge values, are all analog quantities as they are continuous in nature. So temperature of a liquid can be measured using thermometer or a thermocouple, which continuously responds to changes in temperature as liquid is heated up or cooled down. So that is what, because it is a continuous process, so that is going to give you the continuous signal, that continuous output signal is also an analog one. Whereas, if you see a digital sensor, what is going to happen with the digital sensor is, you take the analog signal, and there is going to be a converter, A to D converter, analog to digital conversion. And that once it has been converted to digital, that is, you are going to, the digital data is getting processed here. And sometimes it may sometimes require to have the analog value, and it gives to the corresponding transducer. So why we need to convert into a digital? That is the most important point here. Of course, I told you in the previous discussions, because you do process the digital data. So your computers are all in the digital programming, in the sense that digital processing of data happens. So you cannot have your analog data to be directly processed. That's why you need to have a digital conversion. So the in between in the sense that you can take the value from the sensor, and your microcontroller will be there, which the microcontroller has got an A to D converter, and the microcontroller is nothing but your processor here. That is, can be called as a digital signal processor, and it gives you the corresponding digital value further for you to process the data. So here you might have seen here, if you see in the bottom figure, these are basically, can anybody tell me what is there on the left side of the figure and what is there on the right side of the figure?
Temperature sensor, sir. And right side, yes. Is DHT11.
Yes, DHT, it can be 11, there are different types here, I'll get back.
Or 20,
here.
Yes.
Yeah, so the left side one is a TM35 temperature sensor, and this left side one is basically an analog sensor. Left side one is basically analog one, and the right side one is basically your digital. And this right side one, it has got a digital temperature as well as humidity. Temperature and humidity. So here, whereas this left side one is only having a temperature. And of course, these three pins, basically, can anybody tell me what these three pins can be? This we have discussed in
VCC ground out.
Yeah. So basically, one particular pin will be for getting the some energy to this or to power on this sensor. Another will be like you are connecting to the ground or to the negative. And one more pin will be the output that is coming from this sensor. So you need to power on. And once the power in power on means you connect to a battery. So the plus of the battery is connected. So basically this sensor, whenever you look, every sensor works with different voltages. It can be 3.3, it can be 5 volts, it can be 9 volts, depending on the manufacturer and depending on the type of the sensor, different types of voltages will be given to this. So here in the analog sensor, that is what you see it on the left side, it has got three pins. One pin is for your plus, that is where 5 volts or 3.3, and the other pin will be for connecting to the negative or to the ground. And the other pin is basically the middle pin, most likely will be the output that you get it from this tent. So this is basically an analog sensor. Whereas come to the right side, it is a digital. Digital means, see here, you are going to get the environmental digital humidity and as well as temperature values from the environmental or the ambient temperatures and the humidity. Ambient means the environmental monitoring. So if this sensor collects the environment's temperature and humidity and gives the output, those both humidity and humidity and temperature are going to come as an output from one single pin only. Only thing is, in your program, you are going to distinguish between the temperature and the humidity values. Obviously, the three pins will be corresponds to one pin for your positive, one pin to your negative, and another pin for your output. So these pins and both the sensors are there in our lab. So the next class, I will show you how to connect it and how do you collect the data from these things. That we will see it in the next Friday's class to get some understanding practically. I will show you the video demonstration. And of course, you can also connect these devices remotely from your system too. That setup, we'll do it in the next week. So these are analog to digital. So don't confuse between these types of sensors. And before we move on to this next topic, please let me know any more doubts here, please, about the analog and digital and different what are called sensors and what are called actuators and what is the difference between this. Let me put forward one question here. So what is meant by ADC? ADC stands for?
Analog to digital converter.
Analog to digital conversion. So why you need this analog to digital conversion?
So that our processor can process the information that is being received by the sensors.
So your processor is going to process the data. That information means the data that is represented in the digital form. So if you have, let me just give you a scenario here. So you might have seen in your Arduino boards already. Let me open this Arduino board for you. I hope you can see the screen here now. Right. So here, if you see on the right side of the screen, you have 0 to 5 volts as a power supply. Okay. And you have an Arduino board. Arduino board is basically a microcontroller, like a brain for your work to be done. So what does this brain do? Of course, you need to give inputs to this brain. Assume that you are connecting a temperature sensor. Now, this microcontroller is basically a 10-bit processor. So what is meant by 10-bit processor? You might have studied in your computer organization or computer architecture. What do you mean by 8-bit processor? Hello, am I audible to you, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, what do you mean by 8-bit processor or a 16-bit processor or a 32-bit processor? You mean a processor which processes the data in terms of, if it is an 8-bit processor, it processes in terms of?
It has instruction set, has 8 bits, sir. In case of
the instruction set, yes, it can process 8 bits at a time.
So data, it has 8 data lines that could basically it can process 8 bit data at once.
It can process 8 bit data at a time. At least at a time means it can take 8 bits of data to process the data. If it is 16 bit, it can take 16 bit. So here, this one, this microcontroller is basically a 10 bit data conversion is going to happen for your analog data that it's going to receive. So if your voltage is from 0 to 5 volts, so and if you are using a 10 bit conversion, so 2 power 10 is basically 2 power 10, what is the value of 2 power 10?
1024, sir.
1024.
So you can have a values from 0 to 1023. Totally, you will have 1024 values. So this 0 to 5 volts is divided between this 0 to 1023. So 5 volts is equivalent to 1023, please remember. So whenever you are going to look for a particular 0 to 5 volts analog value, if you want to have the corresponding ADC value, then it is a ratio of this 1023 and the ratio of 1023 and 5 volts. It means it is a ratio between your 1023 and 5 volts. In other terms, it is 1023 divided by 5 is equal to, if you're looking for a particular value of, suppose you are putting a value of 2.5 volts. Can anybody tell me for 2.5 volts, what will be the corresponding ADC value if you are following this 1023 versus 5 ADC conversion? It will be less than, obviously, 1023, half of the 1023, that's what I told. It will be around 511 or 512. Of course, you will get only a digital value. It will be the round off value, 511 or 512. So if it is exactly half, so it is 2.5 means half of 1023, it will be 511 or 512, something like this. So I hope everybody is clear about this ADC conversion values of 1023s and why 1023 is being considered here. Are you clear with this? Because we are going to do some problems in the next few weeks again later. Well, the data, when we are using this temperature sensors or your temperature of DHT or your analog sensors, you will be using this 1023 value conversion value. So that 1023, why is required, is very much everybody should know in this IoT system of applications. Are you clear with this, please?
Yes, sir. Clear.
Yes, sir.
Do some more. Yes, of course, some more problems I'll give you, then you will get more understanding on this. Okay, let us move on to this microcontrollers. So you might have seen this microcontroller, there's so many other types of other microcontrollers. Basically, this is a processing element. Microcontrollers are nothing but does some processing of data. So this processing of data is going to be done with a certain processor, basically a processor in simple terms. So you might have already seen in our latest technology processors. May I know what are the different types of processors which you are aware of so far? In your CPU, in your laptop, or in your desktop, or in your any other, what type of CPUs do you have?
So Intel, Intel and NVIDIA. Intel and AMD.
Yes, you have Intel. You can have NVIDIA's GPU. Those are basically not CPUs, but they are GPUs. NVIDIA's GPUs, and of course, you have other set of manufacturing companies. CPUs are going to be available. So when you see here, the CPUs, they are going to follow certain architecture. Architecture means some types of instruction sets. So that instruction sets which are helpful for you to do some your arithmetic, logical, and your controlling of data. Arithmetic and logical operations and controlling of data, you are going to use of those particular instruction sets. So here we have now something called as advanced RISC machines. Advanced RISC machines, these are called as ARM machines, ARM architectures. ARM stands for Advanced RISC, RISC. RISC, M stands for machines, or Advanced RISC architecture machines. So you might have studied in a computer organization or architecture what is called as a reduced instruction set computer and a complex instruction set computer. Of course, I'm not teaching you the computer organization and architecture again with all the different set of instruction sets, but nevertheless, you should have an idea about the difference between complex instruction set computer and a reduced instruction set computer. So let me just give you a quick brief on this reduced instruction set computer and a complex instruction set computer. Can I know the difference between RISC and CISC, please? Of course, the name itself tells reduced instruction sets. It means there are a number of instruction sets are less as compared to complex instruction set computer. So as you mentioned in your laptops, you might have seen your Intel CPUs, you might have Intel Core processors. So are they following RISC or CISC?
CISC,
very good. So complex instruction set computers, most of your laptops and your laptop processors, your workstations, your tablets, all those things will have a complex instruction. Of course, the number of instructions sets are more number of instruction sets means more functionalities in very simple terms. So more functionalities means more amount of work can be done, more set of different applications can be executed here. In other terms, they are more advanced than basically your reduced instruction set. So these reduced, most of the time you are seeing your mobile phones, your mobile phone will also have a processor. Please remember, your mobile phone, your mobile device is also going to have a processor. Similarly, your Raspberry Pi, which you have seen in the last week's discussion, the Raspberry Pi, it is also a mini computer. It has also got a processor. So that processor is also basically a reduced instruction set computer, RISC. So most of the embedded systems, most of our IoT devices will have this reduced instruction set computers. Means reduced instruction means the number of instruction sets are going to be very less in number, but at the same time, they are advanced reduced instruction set computers. That's why they are been called as advanced RISC machines. R stands for, please remember, in this ARM, A-R-M, R stands for RISC. So what is this ARM features are? So basically these ARM features are, these are 32-bit architectures, but support 16-bit as well as 8-bit data types. So most of your ARM processors are going to be 32-bit ARM processors. And these are programmable as Little Indian or Big Indian. What is meant by Little Indian and Big Indian, please? Little Indian and Big Indian. Little Indian and Big Indian architectures. Most of you might have known these things. Any idea? Anybody can recollect those things?
The way we read the bits or something, left to right.
The way we read the bits, very good, the left to right. So you are going to read your data, basically starting with the lower order bits and you're moving towards right. Sometimes some of those architectures do have read the data from the other side too. So that is basically what most of our processors, we follow this Little Indians and the Big Indians, of course, for the different set of architectures. So advantage of using the CISC in terms is of functionality, along with the advantage of RISC in terms of faster program implementation, as well as the reduced length cores. So in this ARM processors, there are different types of ARM processors in the market as of now. So if you look to the last decade, there is ARM 7, ARM 9, and ARM 11 microprocessors. So this ARM processor, it has got a reduced instruction set core for processing. And of course, these ARM 7, 9, and the latest ARM processors do support the CISC, some of those complex instruction set computers too. So those addressing modes and most of those addressing processes will take place. So this particular, as far as the syllabus is concerned, so we are going to start this ARM processing, and that I'm going to cover it on this next week, Friday. So here we are in this ARM and ARM Cortex processors. That's what in the syllabus we have there. So you can see this latest Raspberry Pi ARM Cortex processors and the Galileo boards. And of course, the we are now anyway discussing the working principles of sensors and actuators. So we will do it more on the microcontroller programming platforms. And once you collect the data from the DHT sensors, we will understand about how do you do the communication system or communication protocols like MQTT, and how do we implement these things using MQTT and the COAP protocols. So these are the, we entered into this second unit now. So yeah, any doubts here, please? So this Raspberry Pi is the ARM Cortex processors. We will go with a little bit more elaborate in the coming class, please. Yeah, any doubts, any other doubts, please, here? Okay, so now I will just give a pause for you here. How many of you have started practicing on this Arduino board, please? So I'll come back to the theoretical part with this ARM processors in the next class. So this particular material, what I discussed today, is already available on the more on sensors and actuators. So you can download it from this our course page. So let me know how many of you have started practicing on this Arduino simulator. No one. Until unless we discuss it, no one is. See, we have done some one or two exercises only in the earlier stage to understand how to do the programming purpose for this, to blink a LED and so on and so forth. Just to blink an LED and to understand what how to write the Arduino code here. Others have not started using these things at all?
So we have started, but we have not done too much.
Too much means, yeah. So
blinking LED is one. Yeah, we did.
Just the same what discussed in class, we did.
Can you please repeat, Amma? What do you say? I did not get you. Whatever I discussed in the class, you have done.
Yes, that we tried. Yes, sir.
No, why? Why you are not exploring more? That's what that is. They say we need to explore more here. Explore means until unless you don't do more practice on this. You will not be having more information and more knowledge here. Can anybody tell me where is the 7-segment display or a LCD display here? In this Arduino board, can anybody tell me where is the display?
To the right side, over here.
Can no, the right side is LED. Don't confuse with the LED with LCD.
No, below that, sir, 7-segment or something is it?
A 7-segment is there. Here, I'm talking about LCD display.
Sir, is it the blue one where the TFT is written?
No, it is not there in this diagram at all. See, if you want to have, that's what you, I think you are not practicing this one. See, if you want some other device, see, all devices are not there in this diagram. See, if you want some other devices like the LCD for the serial peripheral interface, for the I2C communications, these LCDs are not there here. So what we need to do, if you are practicing, then you'll come to know what are all these things, what things are required here. So if something is not present here in this diagram, what you need to do, you need to add that. Suppose, see here, I'm removing this ALT serial in this application. I just remove it, and I'm giving text LCD. Okay, and you click OK here now. Now, if you see here, there is an LCD here. Where is this? This one. So you can write, start programming and see the outputs on your LCD also. This is what the simulator is. Okay, what I'll do is I will put today by afternoon the exercises to be done here. So then only we'll be then exploring the things, I think. So that will be better. Okay, so like this, you see this particular diagram, this is a simulator basically. See, everything is not fit in the same diagram. So you can go to configure, you can go to IO devices, and you can have some other IO devices. Suppose you want to put a stepper motor. In this one, stepper motor is not there. So you can select that and you can add the stepper motor here. And you can see now the diagram. There is a stepper motor here. Servo motor is different. Stepper motor is different. This is a stepper motor. So like this, the motor. Motor means, what are all these motors basically? Motors are your, are the sensors or actuators?
Actuators.
They are
actuators. So if you want to add more components to this, you can add it and you can program it. And see, you already have a DC motor here. So now if you want to have a function generator, so what does a function generator do? So remove this stepper motor here, and now we'll add the function generator here. Anybody, function generator? You might have studied in your 12th class or school days. What does a function generator do, or what does a function generator have? Function, generate. Function, what type of functions does it can generate? Generate means produce. Anyone? Here, what are these function generator? What are these different types of function generator here? There are different types of waves, Amma. The waves here. So by default, which is selected here? The second wave, this is third wave. There are three types of waves here. Waves means a signal. Function generator is basically a signal generator. Have you anybody heard about oscilloscopes?
Yes, sir.
Okay, what is the purpose of an oscilloscope?
Visualizes a current, yeah. Voltage flow or something.
Yes, visualizes your signal. Just say, do not say voltage or current. It visualizes the signal. You can understand the signal behavior. Please remember, an oscilloscope is like an eye of an engineer, eye of an electronics engineer. I means he can see what exactly a signal is behaving, what signal is doing, that everything is going to be seen on the oscilloscope. So here, if you want to get a signal at all, if you want to produce a signal for something, if you want to use a signal to generate a particular set of values, see, in your signals and systems or your computer organization course, you might already study. So there are different types of signals. One is a square wave, and another is a zigzag, and another is a. Suppose a signal, you want to generate it. Signal is some kind of data. Signal is nothing but data only. Please remember, in hardware terminology, a signal is, we call it as a signal. In software terminology, what is a data? So I'll ask the question now, what is meant by data? Because we are all computer scientists know what do you mean by data. So what do you mean by data, anybody? Can anybody tell me what do you mean by data? Data means?
So data is a meaningful information.
Data is a meaningful information. So now everybody, we are all playing with the data only every day. So in hardware terminology, data is nothing but a signal. Please remember, it is a signal. So what is a signal? It is also a meaningful information. As far as the hardware device is concerned. See, all your data processing techniques, please remember, people usually get afraid because they think that they don't know hardware knowledge and something like that. It is not like that at all. Let me give you some information here for all of you. You are doing some data processing, right? If I ask you the question in another way, what do you mean by data mining? Anybody, can you tell me what do you mean by data mining? You are all in the final years, final semesters only, most of you.
Finding useful data in information.
Information. So, Deepika, please remember, information and data. Data is basically a plural thing.
Information is useful data.
Information is useful data. You should say some patterns, important patterns which you're looking from the data mining, some important patterns in other terms. You are trying to search some important thing from the existing data. So here, the same thing, data is nothing but signal in hardware terminology. Please all of you remember, whatever you are doing, the data processing, the data mining and all, it is same thing is going to happen in the signal processing also. So most of you might have, before doing some data mining or before applying some machine learning algorithm for your data, you usually do have data pre-processing. You know what is meant by pre-processing? Pre-processing means some kind of unwanted data, you have to remove it. Or if unknown data is there, you have to fill it up. Some kind of pre-processing data is there so that you can do meaningful extractions of the data, or you can do some machine learning. It means artificial intelligence can be properly implemented. Some techniques can be applied on the data properly to infer proper decisions. So these are some data processing techniques. The same thing happens in the signal processing also. In signal processing, you have something called filtering. Filtering is nothing but pre-processing only. You are going to eliminate some unwanted data. You are going to look for only wanted data. So all these steps, please don't confuse. Don't get yourself vexed. Don't get your mind deviated. Both signal and data both mean the same. Whatever you do with the hardware, nowadays you are doing software. Whatever you are doing with the software, nowadays you are doing with the hardware. So both are going to be in one day or some other day. So both are going to be one and the same, maybe. We cannot say now. Because the activities, the functionalities, the only hardware you can feel and touch, whereas in software you cannot touch, you cannot feel it. So that is the thing. In the hardware terminology, those hardware things you can have the sense, touching sense, but in the software, that kind of touch sense is not there. That is the only difference. Other than that, nothing else is there. So here, what I'm trying to say here is, you please, with this function generator, you can generate the signals. The signals means you can generate the data, that data which can be given to some of the pins and you process the data. So please don't ignore this kind of simulators. There's got a lot of functionalities are there, a lot of you have to practice it. I have given you the exercise. So what is the assignment problem I have given to you for using this Arduino simulator? At least please recollect this one. So what are the components you require here? For that assignment problem?
Sir, LEDs, yes, buttons.
Sir, one was to use the variable voltage and to read the analog value from variable voltage and dim LED based on the values.
That is one exercise. Another one, so here there is a, you can use an LED here and you can use this variable voltage. It means you can change this potential, like you can use this variable resistor as a potentiometer here. You can change the variations in these voltages and you need to glow the LED here. That is one exercise. Another exercise I might have given is servo exercise. Did I give you the servo motor? This servo motor, if you see on my screen, where my cursor is blinking here, this servo motor, you can rotate this particular shaft, the left towards left and towards right. That can be controlled from this variable resistor. Did I give this assignment to you?
Yes, sir. You have given.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Please do practice this one. So this only 1 week time is there for you. So in this week you need to complete this Arduino so that the second assignment will be on Raspberry Pis, and we can go for the machine learning in the Raspberry Pis. Once we start Raspberry Pis, we will not come back to this Arduino. So anyway, I'll give some more exercises today using this Arduino boards. You can just practice it. Okay, the point what I mean to say here is, so please do these exercises on using this function generator. Of course, if you Google it using YouTube, you can see many exercises actually. You can use this help menu. Please use this quick help. You can see how to use this particular Arduino and you can understand various things. You can see a signal here, can understand how the data is coming in the digital form. So digital waveforms are there. So please see this very simple, already the material is there with you. If I have to give you, I have to just copy and give to you. But if you start reading these things, that will be very much useful for you. This is, see in the bottom figure, your difference between analog signal and a digital signal. You can easily understand between how the analog value is varying from 0 to 5 volts here, and how the digital signal is getting varied here. And this value is going to be monitored using pin number 2 and pin number 3 here. So if you connect a digital signal to this, you know how to connect to the pins I have shown in the examples. So pin 2, if you make as an analog or a digital, you can make it here. See, you can, that's what I am. Now I'm, nothing is there on the pin to you. There is no data here as of now. So can anybody connect this and see the digital waveform? Can I see from your system now? At least for the LED blink. Can anybody write a program and show me now? Can anybody want to just, I want to make sure that you also can do those things. So I will ask somebody to volunteer now. Same, take the same example here and you see the waveform on the particular pin. And also you can send the waveforms to a particular pin from this function generator. There are two ways here, please understand here. Okay, let me just show you. So can anybody volunteer to take up the task? I'll tell the instructions so that it will be easy for you to understand. Nobody is sitting on front of the computer? Yes, please.
Okay, sir, I'll do.
Yeah, very good. Neha has come forward. Really good. I'll just stop presenting from my side. What I'm asking you is, you have done the LED blink exercise?
Yes, sir.
So just open the program of LED blink exercise.
Okay.
This is not a very big task at all. It's a very simple task. Open the LED blink exercise now.
Sure.
Very good. Yeah. So the LED pin is connected to pin number
13.
Number 13. Yeah.
And sir, is this visible?
Yeah, now you pin number 13, you you put your so put your mouse pointer on the pin number 13 there.
Okay,
double click there. Yes, now you see the waveforms here.
Yes, sir.
So now can you just maximize that little bit, the waveform? I'm not getting the small. So here the can anybody tell me the wave is from what is the low value and what is the high value?
So 0 and 1.
Yes, 0 and 1 is, that's what your digital. This is basically a digital waveform, because this pin number 13. What is pin number 13 is connected to?
Output.
Output of this LED. Output. That LED is going to work with only this is a digital waveform. That's why you are getting the digital wave here. That is a digital signal, basically. Are you getting this point?
Yes, sir.
You are in the pin number 13. Now, this is same way, similarly, I'm asking, you connect to any other pin with analog values and see the waveforms properly. And if you want to see those analog values, you can see now later you connect to the servo motors, the assignment which I'm going to already given to you. The servo motor, you connect to the pin number and you just see the visualize the pin number of that servo motor which you connected it. Then you will understand the analog also.
Okay.
Okay, so this is not a very big task and very simple, but at least you should see the features of this one. So don't ignore this. That's what I was telling to you. Okay, anyway. Yep. Yeah, any other queries, please, regarding this Arduino simulator here? Now you can stop presenting, Amma. You can stop
sure,
presenting.
sir. Sure.
Sir?
Yes, please. Yes, please.
So not regarding the simulator, but how do I physically connect external components to the Arduino board? Like I have a physical LCD component, but I don't know how to connect it to the board.
Have LCD?
Yes, sir. I have the physical component.
You have it now?
Yeah, I have it.
You are having Arduino board or Raspberry Pi?
Arduino.
Arduino board is there, huh? Okay. Then can we do one thing? So next week, Friday class, we will put the demonstrations only. Is it okay if you discuss it in the next week?
Yes, sir. Sure.
I will ask you to you only to prepare your so keep the things ready for your the demonstration, so the other students also can see it. So I will give the instructions and you can connect it. And
okay,
do you
sir.
Have any do you have any sensors with you? Sensors.
I don't have too many sensors, sir. I'll check once.
Yeah, at least some DHT sensor. Or any
no, sir. I don't have.
What
I have,
have
a servo motor.
Servo motor. Then even at least sensors. What other sensors are you having?
I will just check and let you know, sir. I don't have all of them right now.
Because,
I'll just check and let
yeah,
you know.
Yeah. So what we will do is we will try to get the sensor values to be displayed on that LCD.
Okay, sir.
That we will see it on the so make it make the things ready. You have a breadboard and you have the Arduino board and your LCD and one or two sensors. You can keep it ready at least.
Okay, sir.
See it. Yeah. So then we will connect it. If you have a DHT sensor, then that will be useful for us or for everybody to understand it very simply. Actually, a quick way to understand that. So
I
that
don't have that, sir.
Only just it will cost you around 5 to 10 rupees.
Okay.
Most likely. Anyway, you let me know what sensors do you have so that we will make it ready in the next week. Okay.
Okay, sir.
It is something has to be displayed on the LCD. Something has to display means some sensor at least is required so that you can see those values on the LCD. That we will see it on the next week. Any other queries, please? So this week I will wind up the session now a little bit early. If you have any queries, please let me know.
Sir, one small doubt I have. Sir, actually in assignment there is one question that using Fritzing circuit we need to collect one LED and potentiometer, right? So we need for the microcontroller we need to use Arduino Raspberry Pi.
Sir. See, you should not confuse between. You asked me microcontroller. You need to use Arduino Raspberry Pi. Raspberry Pi is a mini computer. It is not a microcontroller. Your Arduino board itself is a microcontroller. That's all.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So you usually in your Arduino Uno and Arduino Mega. That is a Mega and Uno, basically you have a microcontroller. That is itself is a microcontroller. It is not a computer, mini computer. Only mini computer is your Raspberry Pi. Yeah, I told several times there is a difference between a microcontroller and your computer. The computer will have your operating system too. Please remember this. In your Arduino board, you will not have an operating system at all.
Okay, sir.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, I have a DHT sensor.
You have DHT? Okay. Do you have any Arduino board with you?
Yes, sir. Complete. I have a starter kit, sir.
Oh, very good. If you have kit, then can you use it now? Do you have it now?
Actually, I don't know how to operate. I just got yesterday, sir.
Oh, okay. Then can you connect your camera to that? Is it possible for you?
For what, sir? showing components.
So you can connect from your side and you can show those to your friends also.
Okay, see.
If you, is it possible for you? No, you connect it. Otherwise, we will see it on the next week. Either.
Visible, sir?
Sorry?
I'm visible, sir?
No. We cannot see you.
No, sir.
No, not yet, Baba.
Actually, my camera is not opening, sir.
Oh, my God.
I don't know why.
Yeah. At least make it, try for the next week, Friday.
Okay, yeah. Sir. I will go through it and.
No, have you. See, those you have Arduino and DHT sensor, have you seen this LED blink exercise?
No, I have not done that one because my laptop is not working properly. So I haven't installed simulation. Simulators.
Okay. Yeah, if you are not done simulator, if you are done before you do it on the real system, once you do it on the once you practice your LED on this one. Okay.
On simulator, sir.
See, before you work it on your real system, you please practice once how to write program, the Arduino program here on the left side of the screen. Can you see that program IDE? You can type the program here. How to, and this Arduino .io.info file consists of your function, your setup function, and your loop function. Have you attended that session?
Yes, sir, I have attended, sir.
But so not, you know how to write the program?
Yes, sir, I can.
Sorry?
Yes, sir, I can do, sir.
You can do. See, this is basically the simulator one. So on your laptop.
Sir, your screen is not visible, sir.
Oh, sorry. I'm just, I forgot this. Yeah, see, mostly you might have seen this one, the Arduino simulator. So here you have your pins are there, your 0 to 13. And on the other side, you have analog pins. So these are these pins can be multiplexed one. Basically, you can have analog as well as digital pins. So on the left side of the screen, you have this editor. So this editor, you have entered the program using the setup function and your loop function. This is basically related to your simulator. If you have a real Arduino board with you, then already I suggested you can go to this, install your Arduino IDE, like what I'm showing it on this. So it is a free software, there is not a problem. If you have Arduino board, you can install this Arduino IDE, Integrated Development Environment. This is how your program looks like. It's the same thing, the setup and the loop function. So here you have to set up your digital. If you are connecting your DHT temperature sensor, then you in the setup function you connect which pins you are going to connect onto your Arduino board, and in this particular loop function you can write your program here to read the data of temperature and the humidity, and you can print the values here. Okay, so that value is going to be printed onto your console window once it is program is in the run state. So this one, if you can make your Arduino board and the DHT sensor ready. So next week, you just make your camera also ready so that I will tell you how to connect and how to.
Okay, sir. I will do it.
Yeah, so just make your camera ready, then you'll do it.
Okay.
Any other queries, please? See the values of your DHT sensor.
Okay, sir. I will do it.
Yeah, so just make your camera ready, then you'll do it. Any other queries, please?
Sir, does the ADC happen in Raspberry Pi, sir? Like, it has no analog pins.
Yeah, you are absolutely very good question. See, basically, your Raspberry Pi will not have your ADC conversion. You need to have somehow, when you are connecting the data itself, there should be some other mechanism for you to convert your analog to your digital value. depends on you. That depends on your the instrumentation part and the sensing part, where the sensor is also connected to other ADC microcontroller, and from that you can connect the data to your Raspberry Pi.
Sir, so that temperature sensor, like, we cannot interface it through Raspberry Pi or something, TM11 or?
TM11 you cannot do it, but DHT you can have it.
Yes, sir. Like, can we extend our board to do this, like some extension module or?
Yes, you can make the Arduino and Raspberry Pi connect together.
Yes, sir.
You can connect your Arduino and Raspberry Pi together so that your Arduino board will be connected to the TMP35. And once you get the digital value, you collect the data from the digital pin of your Raspberry Pi. This, of course, since you cannot physically present, this type of experiments we already done. And if you are really present in the lab, that should be great. But anyway, this also we can also do all these things. But some only video demonstration, I will show you how to do those things from next week onwards. Any other queries, please? Yeah. Okay, then if there are no queries, then I'll wind up the session here half an hour early for today. And we will meet again on Friday class again. Is it okay?
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.